This week on Arts InSight, North Korea in 3D.
By connecting to the younger people in Korea today, it can really help us consider and ponder where is Korea going.
How one artist crafts intricate paper creations.
It's the only kind of public place where people just can come in from anywhere and learn how to make paper in the Korean tradition from scratch.
An intricate exploration of communication and space.
We really rely on this postal delivery system, this kind of social infrastructure that a lot of commerce was built around.
Capturing the beauty of nature.
It's boring, it's flat, there's no pretty landscape, no mountains, no oceans. Well, there's no mountains or oceans, but we do have beautiful landscapes.
And a history worn and preserved.
It is the act of the weaving that puts me in touch with all that there is. And it's the wearer who feels all that power and energy.
I'm Ernie Manous, and it's time to get Arts InSight. Welcome to Arts InSight. We're below Buffalo Bayou Park at the very first installation inside the cistern. It's called Rain. Stick around and get a closer look, and we'll even find out how it was designed. But first, an exhibit in Houston gives a rare glimpse at life in North Korea. The photos capture a uniquely three-dimensional image of the people.
There's sort of an interesting experience you have when you're there. Where are you in this continuum of reality? The North Korean government is very eager to make a positive impression on foreigners and visitors, and many of the sites that you are allowed to visit are really considered kind of model environments. Yes, we all accept that when you're shooting anything in North Korea, there's going to be this sliding scale of reality, but I think that's interesting for us as viewers, is to see where do we think he landed on that scale. We're pleased to have 3D PRK, North Korean Portraits by Mariaj Tanchich on view right now at Asia Society Texas Center. So to unpack the title of the exhibition a little bit, we refer commonly to North Korea as just that, but its official title is the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, so DPRK. And then that combined with 3D gets us the exhibition title and the title of the series, which is 3D PRK. We were really interested in featuring the exhibition because Mariaj has a very unique perspective. He grew up in Slovenia, which at the time was part of the former Yugoslavia. So he grew up in a communist system. So he becomes kind of a cultural translator. And he has an extensive background in photography, is very gifted, but he also has a unique capacity to shoot in 3D. 3D is so effective in taking us out of our everyday immediate location and putting us into a different space. And by using the sort of science of optics, it allows us to travel without even leaving our chairs. So I think what he wanted to do in making this one-to-one connection was to really take us to where he had been in North Korea, to really engage us in a conversation with these subjects that he selected, these individuals he worked with. And I think 3D does that in a way that normal photography could never achieve, really. Really, the old saw, you know, everything old is new again. It's the cyclical nature of things. But I think when a photograph in 3D is very well composed, even with putting on the very retro glasses that you could have been wearing in the 60s, you can have a very complete experience. And especially when you activate 3D with these glasses, by shifting slightly left to right or front to back. We've had some of our visitors say they almost feel kind of a seasickness because they're so enveloped in the space and the composition that he creates. One in particular is a young man who's working in a steelworks near a furnace. Mariaj will tell you that that is just, it was such a beautiful image. It just sort of called out to him when they were there. And I think part of the reason is it's sort of the classic heroic worker type that you see in socialist realist propaganda imagery, whether that be posters or photography or whatever. But we paired it also with two other photographs, one of a young woman working at a tourist rest stop, and then two young women who are in attendance at a shooting range. And I think that by connecting to the younger people in Korea today, it can really help us consider and ponder, where is Korea going? Where will Korea be in the next 20 years, in the next 50 years, when they have these young people who have limitless potential and are so bright and capable? And I think that they really encapsulate what he is trying to convey with his work and what we're trying to convey with the exhibition.
The exhibit is open through February 26th. Visit asiasociety.org for more information. Now we're inside the cistern underneath Buffalo Bayou Park, exploring a new installation called Rain. Joining us to tell us all about it is Museum of Fine Arts Houston director, Gary Tintoreau. Hello, Gary.
Hey, Ernie.
So, as I understand it, the MFA actually owns this piece.
Yeah, you know, with like all conceptual art, it's sort of hard to own it. We own a tape that allows us to make a projection in a space.
So the idea wasn't to originally have it placed here.
No, it's a work of art. Well, Magdalena Fernandez, who's a Venezuelan artist, is an artist that our museum has been involved with for some years. And we were pleased to be able to buy one of her pieces with our Caribbean Art Fund, because, you know, Venezuela borders on the Caribbean. And so it's a piece that was meant to be displayed in a museum gallery in a rectangle. But when I was invited to see the cistern soon after its renovation and asked to propose possible installations to animate the space, I immediately thought of this wonderful piece. What's remarkable about Magdalena Fernandez is that she took an iconic image from early 20th century abstraction, Piet Mondrian's plus and minus sign, a series of very austere abstractions that he did just before World War I. Sometimes it's called the Pier and Ocean, Pier and Sea series, where the image of the waves and a seascape and a pier jutting out to it was the creation of a set of abstract paintings that were simply geometric with no human dimension whatsoever. And from those came his mature work, which were color blocks and black lines. What she did was take that plus and minus, project it onto these columns here or in the space in the gallery space in the museum, but adds the human dimension, which is the chorus of snapping, which sounds like rain. It's not really rain. I call them Slovenian snappers. It's a group called Perpetuum Jazzile, the Jazz Perpetuum, and they snap their fingers in order to make this ever increasing sound of rain, a higher intensity rain. And then the best part is the thunderclaps, which are not them clapping, but literally jumping up in the air.
Well, we're jumping up and down and thrilled that this is the first piece here in the cistern.
I think it works really well, and we were delighted to collaborate with Buffalo Bayou Partnership. They were tremendous partners.
Well, thank you so much for sharing it.
Always happy to see you, Ernie.
Learn even more about the installation and the cistern itself at buffalobayou.org. Okay, in Cleveland, there's a woman who creates paper art inspired by a traditional Korean gift.
In Korea, there's a tradition when people get married that one of the very common gifts they get is they get pairs of wooden ducks, wedding ducks, and they're carved and then they're painted these beautiful colors to signify Mandarin ducks, which are a species that are known to mate for life. I always grew up seeing them, you know, every kind of household, every married couple has them.
The Korean tradition of offering newlyweds wooden ducks dates back 2,000 years to a time when male suitors offered families live ducks in exchange for someone's hand in marriage. As a way of paying homage to this custom, Amy produced a series of Mandarin ducks using another ancient Korean practice, papermaking.
Papermaking in Korea is almost 2,000 years old. It has very long history, and it was maybe one of the second kind of big cultures that started to make paper in the world. And so it started in China and then went to Korea because they were very closely connected. And it came first as a vehicle for religion, for Buddhism, for a way for them to copy their sutras and then be able to disseminate this information. And then beyond that, they started to realize how strong this paper was, and they realized they could turn it into so many other things. And you had paper chamber pots, you had paper furniture, you had hats, you had all kinds of things.
The paper Amy uses to craft her ducks is derived from the mulberry tree. The plants are grown at the Morgan Art of Papermaking Conservatory on East 47th Street in Cleveland, where Amy teaches the ancient art of Korean papermaking.
We've waited until all of the leaves have fallen, and we're cutting all the way at the base of this plant, and it will grow right back the next year. So this inner bark, the white bark, is what you want for papermaking. It's the only kind of public place where people just can come in from anywhere and learn how to make paper in the Korean tradition from scratch.
Extracting the pulp used to make paper is a laborious process. It starts by steaming the branches so the bark can be removed. The inner stem is then boiled and the long fibers are removed. After cleaning, the fibrous material is beaten, creating short strands of pulp that go into a watery solution known as a slurry. A large screen goes into the slurry many times and in many directions to evenly distribute the fibers and drain off the water. What's left behind is a thin layer of fibrous material that becomes paper.
Principally, the fibers are lining up, you know, crossing each other hair-like, and with water they wind up and they become like that, and as they come down they compress on themselves, so it's amount of how much pressure, what type of techniques, what kind of fibers, what gives you strength. Actually, when you compress the fibers and you, the density of paper is actually higher than like a wood, because you're actually compressing it and taking things and making them even denser. And it's hard to get around that in the sense of how we relate to paper, but if you were to make a piece of furniture out of compressed, even if it was compressed cotton, it is as strong or stronger than that same density of wood.
After the paper dries, Amy begins assembling the ducks by first cutting handmade paper into 1-inch strips that are woven together into string.
I use my hands to essentially twist and ply the paper. It's exactly like making rope. This is the process known as cistern, and cistern is this very old craft form in Korea of taking these strips of paper and then twisting them. I have to do that for one end of the strips, and then I have to turn it around and sit on the other end so I can finish the entire length of the strip. And I have to do that then for hundreds and hundreds of pairs so that I get hundreds and hundreds of cords so that I can start weaving.
Traditional basket-making techniques are used to weave the string into a duck.
The process is called twining, which is a basketry and a very old process that almost every culture in the world actually has developed. And so you have to take these paper cords, and I usually start with a knot that ends up giving me 8 different cords come shooting out of a center and just go round and round and round and round until it gets bigger. And to make it get bigger and stay flat, I have to then add more of these ropes, which I usually call spokes, because it is like spokes in a wheel. And then the pieces that go around, the threads that go around, are called weavers. I do think the hardest part of making the ducks is making a really smooth, continuous curve. You know, when I think about potters and the way that they shape things to make them round, or sculptors, and they can kind of control that in a different way. I have to think about how to do that, but in a way where you're using building blocks. You know, how do you make Legos that are square look like they're making a curve? It's the same problem.
I am inspired by what Amy does. I mean, and her dedication to the craft, probably 40 to 60 hours in a duck. And to see the various twists and turns, the nature and the size of each, some of the colorations and things like that, they were all like, well, this is, you know, for me. And then knowing, you know, deep down, I know exactly what kind of effort and time went into each one of those. And I've seen her make them, so I know, you know, visually I can, you know, so that educates me before I even see it. So that was, you know, a treat to see them, and then to even see them in nests and oddball, like random things that she actually wove the nest just to place them in as kind of a presentation. It's just, you know, it has a light side, a very light side to it. It has a traditional side to it.
Using these traditional papermaking techniques and sustainable practices are essential to Amy for many reasons, but especially as a way of connecting to her Korean heritage and her love of history and humanity.
It's important to me, I think, in the big picture, just as a human being on this planet that cares about preserving craft traditions that humans have figured out over hundreds of years. You know, it took a long time to figure out how to make such a fine and beautiful and useful product. And also, it's important for me as a papermaker to round out papermaking history. There hasn't been a lot of information about Korean paper, and there's been a lot more research done in other kinds of papermaking, and so I just wanted to kind of fill a gap that I saw.
You can find out more by visiting amylee.net. Up next, an interactive installation in Minnesota explores how we send messages, both physically and digitally.
General delivery is an interactive exploration of how information gets delivered through space, both physically and digitally. It's really a project in two parts. Where a lot of people begin is by writing a note and sitting at this desk and creating this physical form of communication. When you write a note, you put it through a mail slot and press a button, and there's a little camera that takes an image of it and uploads it to the internet. I was interested in looking at how mail is delivered and how we really rely on this postal delivery system, this kind of social infrastructure that a lot of commerce was built around in the past, and how that's changing now that we're entering this digital era and kind of adapting to new technologies and other ways of communicating with each other over long distances. You know, I try to make it pretty non-explanatory, and people figure it out and they feel a little bit confused and a little bit disoriented, but I think that's really good. I think that really speaks to what I was trying to accomplish with this.
You can follow Emily Stover on her Tumblr to see more of her public art. Now, a photographer in Columbus has made a career out of capturing some of the city's most notable people and events, but it's his love of nature that has him turning his lens toward the landscape.
Well, we're here at Upper Falls in the Old Man's Cave region of Hocking Hills.
Hocking Hills is really a magical place. People say, oh, Ohio, it's boring, it's flat, there's no pretty landscape, no mountains, no oceans. Well, there's no mountains or oceans, but we do have beautiful landscapes, and I think Hocking Hills is the nicest in the state. When you get down there at the right time, it's gorgeous.
We got a decent amount of water coming over the falls today. I've set up a shot here that I kind of like because the hemlock branches are framing the falls nicely. Hopefully we'll end up with an image that's one that isn't seen every day.
I try to travel as light as I can when I'm out in the field. Just tripod, two or three lenses, camera body.
This is the Devil's Bathtub. Sometimes there's some cool compositions down in here, depending upon how much water's flowing. It's a little light today.
I started my career in the advertising business and worked in that for 16 years and picked up photography as a hobby along the way. And so I slowly made the transition over the course of a couple years from the advertising agency business to photography, and really never looked back.
Well, I like to tell people that I photograph people and places. So a lot of my work is portraiture, and then I photograph quite a bit of events. And then I also do a lot of landscape and nature photography. Well, right now we're down here at the Cascades, which are right above Middle Falls, and getting some nice light coming through, streaming through the trees, getting a little bit of light beams and nice reflections on the water. Using a really slow shutter speed here to add motion to the water and get that nice cotton candy kind of feel to it. I usually go to Colorado every fall. It's probably my favorite place to photograph. I just love it out there. One of my favorite subjects to photograph are aspen trees. There's just so much personality to them, the trunks, the leaves, the way they change, the way they look in the spring, the way they look in the fall, the way they look in the summer. Plus, it's just great to be out there in the mountain air with them. So I print all my own work here in the studio, and I use an Epson 7880. It's a large format printer. It's capable of printing 24 inches wide by, 6 or 8 feet long. I think one of the hallmarks of my photography is detail. I really like a lot of detail in my images and my prints. When you get out there in nature, it's great to get away from the hustle and bustle. I find it's a very invigorating way to kind of recharge the battery, so to speak, and give me a creative spark in my commercial work.
Visit rickbuchananphotography.com to learn more. And finally tonight, for an indigenous tribe from the Pacific Northwest, art is more than just a means of expression. It's a way of preserving history.
The reason why I weave, it's like no other medium that I've ever worked in that connects me to the past and the present and the future. I take the fiber from an animal and a plant. In so doing, it is the act of the weaving that puts me in touch with all that there is, and it's the wearer who feels all that power and energy. Our art was depicted in everything. And that was a way to portray, you know, our identity, you know, where we came from, since it was a matrilineal society. But also it was our written language. We wore our history in our regalia. We still wear it. We didn't have a written language. It was all oral, translated, you know, passed on from generation to generation. But with the oral history, there was always an art object that went with every story, that went with every historical event. The stories come from everyday life, whatever happens, whatever it is that you want to preserve for future generations. We want to tell a people where they're from, what happened, how did they come to be where they are. It's not just livelihood, it's part of retaining history. call this piece Resilience. And it's Resilience Chilkat Robe. And what that is, it's like, it's a visual document of the ability of a people to adapt to outside forces that came into the culture. In that image, you'll see the foundation of our clan system, the eagle and the raven in the center. And then there's the outside influences. Within the eagle and the raven, you'll see the Alaska Native Brotherhood, ANB, and the ANS. And these civil rights groups gave flight to the rights of the indigenous people. And then at the bottom is the tail. And what that represents, it's the Sea Alaska Heritage Institute logo. And they are now the present day rudder as far as helping to retain and perpetuate the native cultures in present day Western society. Resilience, the ability to adapt so that we continue to thrive. I keep stories alive because there's always something to learn. And even when the stories are repeated over and over and over again, and you hear them, you know, 20 times in your life or 100 times in your life, right? You, at that stage in your life, you always get something else out of the story.
There they are. There's Lewis.
Hi.
Look, little socks. Little socks. Baby socks.
And when we tell our stories, they are a guide from the past through now into the future. That's why we tell stories.
You can find out more by visiting clarissarizal.com. And from the cistern at Buffalo Bayou Park, that does it for this edition of Arts Insight. For all of us here at Houston Public Media, I'm Ernie Manous. Thanks for watching, and have a great week.